this presentation, about 10-20 minutes, including a demonstration of tri-brick modeling from my colleague Ian. First of all, very quickly, some principles on 3D CAD in general. Maybe most of you have been using 3D CAD systems, some of you may have not. So I will explain some principles, so that's clear what you see later on in this part of the training. Then something on the automation of the design process. I told you in the introduction, there's a lot of know-how involved, and a lot of know-how coming from other sources than geometrical data, and we all need to combine it. And as a human being, we can make mistakes, and when we try to automate it, put a lot of know-how in the system, we try to avoid that. Then something totally new, computer-aided design for functionally graded materials. We're only talking about a shell or a solid, but not on what's happening inside in a product. And I will give you some ideas on that one. And then, as said, Ian Ramescroft will say something on tri-brick modeling. When you look at the full training program on principles for CAD, this is it. It's about a 3 days training course, but we don't have the time for that. As said before in the introduction, you can find the custom fit version in the beginning of January on the Moodle platform. You can also already find a Delcam version via the Delcam website. And you can download it, all the lectures, including tasks you want to do. You can download freely some software, so you can play around if you want. But the custom fit version, that's why we are here, is available from the 1st of January on a Moodle platform. As said, I will not discuss everything. I will concentrate very quickly on some types of CAD objects and then on the modeling methodologies. Sorry for the difficult word for me. We all know what a point is in a CAD system, and when we combine points with lines, you saw it Ian already doing, we can combine it and we can come to a surface very easily. That's the basics of surface modeling. You have points, you make lines, and from the lines you can make a surface. What is a solid? You can represent a solid in different ways, but the most used way is doing the boundary representation. Then you put all kinds of solid surfaces together, and you have a box closed, and that is a solid. So quite easy. We have points, we have lines, we have wireframes making a surface, and all surfaces together can be a solid. The real difference between surfaces and solids, take a sphere, and when you cut through the surface description of a sphere, you end up with an open sphere. When you make a cut through of a solid of a sphere, you end with, let's say, half of a golf ball. So that's the difference between a solid and a surface representation. There's inside always material, and with a surface description, there's air inside. Then there's something else. You saw it already in a demonstration of Ian, and that's a faceted model. Normally, it's being generated from a reverse engineering machine. There are some advantages by using it. It's quite easy to create and to understand. Everybody knows what it is doing. But also some disadvantages. To maintain high accuracy, you need a very large number of facets, and you need to have a big memory in your computer systems to cope with it. When you want to edit it smoothly, it will take some time. You see that in a system like that was presented before, there are some tools available. Also in the materialized software, there are tools available. But still, it's not the perfect representation of a surface. But from a reverse engineering background, you can do a lot of good things with it. The next step is voxel models. We all know what a pixel is when you have a camera, and a voxel is a 3D representation of a pixel. So when you have this shape, you can represent it with all kinds of Lego blocks, and in the end, when you make them smaller and smaller, you have a voxel model of your product. Advantages, also very easy to understand, but also to get high accuracy, you need a lot of those little cubes, so that takes a lot of memory. Also, the smoothing is quite difficult. Why am I telling this? Because later on, when we're talking about the graded design of products, we use voxel representations. So we've been looking at points, we've been looking at lines, wireframe surfaces and solids, triangulated data, and voxel models. That are the main representations of CAD geometries at the current moment. Or when somebody knows a new one, please say so. No? Not another representation? No, I can go on. Okay, modeling methodologies. We saw already in the demonstration a few of them. I only will very quickly describe when can we use surface modeling, when can we use solid modeling. Surface modeling is mainly used for making freeform surfaces, but for instance, when you want to make an engine block, you can better use a solid modeling approach because it's building parts and pieces together. When you look at a motorbike, the outside, well done with surface modeling, the inside, the engine, can be very quickly done with solid modeling. When looking at surface solid modeling and those voxels and triangle modeling, what can I do? For instance, this kind of stuff, which is having embossing on products, just like the Wedgwood stuff, or what we saw from the Royal Dool tree, or whatever it was, that kind of technologies are mainly made by using voxel or triangle modeling, or this kind of toys with Mickey Mouse on it. We use triangulated data. What you can very nicely do on that kind of data is using a sculpting device and make a freeform sculpting yourself. So for instance, when you put on a picture of yourself and you don't like your own face, you can use the sculpting tool, cut away your nose or your glasses or whatever. That's what you can do very nicely. We've been discussing very briefly surface modeling, solid modeling. There's also hybrid modeling. There you use the flexibility and the speed of both the surfaces and the solids. But there's also something new that is called tribrid modeling that has been developed in this custom fit project. And then we can use everything. We can use the triangles, we can use the surfaces and the solids, and we can do bending, twisting and sculpting parts interactively. So we can make any kind of shape we want. So we are spending loads of money in such a project. We're making nice machines for rubber manufacturing, but also, as an example, we make new software so that we have, let's say, an enormous amount of possibilities to create surfaces and to create geometries. That was a little bit about the principles of 3D CAD, what has been developed. So what is new coming from such a project? As said before, when you want to have a play around yourself, go to the website of Moodle at the beginning of next year, or to the Delcam website to download some stuff. Now, automating the design process. First, I will tell a very shortly a general story on the product design system, and then I will use the helmet case and the toy seat case to explain what we've been doing in the project and how it's all working together. What is the system doing? It is scanning a person. We have seen in a presentation of David that we have different methodologies, but we scan the data from the patient or the customer. Then we use a kind of a template, for instance of the helmet. It's a standard helmet for one of our partners in the project. And what we do is we morph that data together. So the data of the patient or the customer together with the template provided by the customer. We use for that a dedicated user interface with only some simple tools to make some small adjustments when needed. What is happening in that tool? We interrogate the scan file, so we look at the person over there, maybe we add some specific points so that we assure that the helmet is in the right position and not vice versa, because it would be not so healthy. Then we morph the template, we do some editing internally of the result, and then we export the STL file for the web manufacturing machine. Within this project, we have used the PowerShape system to do it all on one platform. Custom fitting helmet. Why on earth do we need a custom fitting helmet? I already told you, these are not fitting so well. And we did an investigation, and about 5% of the motorcyclists, they cannot find a helmet that's fitting well. Also, 15 to 20% of the full face composite helmets are ill-fitting. You see it over here. This is a normal helmet, this is a normal person. There's a gap in here, and there's also a gap in here. What we've been doing is, when you look at the helmet, what is that helmet doing? When you have an accident, you're on the ground, the outer shell stops immediately, and then inside your head keeps on going when it collides with the polystyrene stuff inside. And it's the job of the EPS to bring the head to a gentle stop if we want our brain to work normally. In my case, it can be maybe better once to have such an accident without a custom fit helmet, but this is generally the idea of having a helmet. We cannot try to redesign the whole helmet, that's too expensive. So within the project, well,